So good afternoon, everyone. So thank you for having me. I'm really pleased to come back to EPOG, really a beautiful interdisciplinary and critical master, international one. So really a thriving master. By the way, as you can hear, I'm French. I have a terrible French accent. So at least I'm consistent with you know, that kind of thing. So please do not hesitate to just ask for clarification, questions, or just interrupt me if you don't understand what I say. So I'm going to present you a working paper, a paper made with Pierre Jacques, who is a PhD student at Université catholique de Louvain in Belgium. It's a paper about models. So don't worry, I didn't put math. Maybe we will do just a bit of math of modeling on the board, but it's mainly about political economy of models and building bridges, critical bridges between academic institutions and public policy-making institutions like the European Commission, but also the World Bank, the IMF, and that kind of thing. So just to give a few words about the context. So last year at the European Parliament, oh yes, the mic just dropped. Yeah, sorry. Last year at the European Parliament, there have been a huge conference, an international conference, Beyond Growth, the Beyond Growth conference organized by European Parliament members and under the impetus of the President of the European Commission. And it gathered lots of scientists, public policymakers, NGOs, activists, ecological activists, and economists in order to think about the ecological transition, the energy transition, the ecological planning and transformation, and maybe even the degrowth for the European continent, which was quite a really interesting thing, you know, to bring that kind of perspectives in two institutions that are usually based on austerity policy, on market and deregulation, free market, perfect competition, at least in the inner European market. And so after this conference, the goal was to, you know, to try to foster things, not only to organize a conference, but to start to build research communities in order to show to other economies that, in fact, we are not only criticizing models and their limitations and their shortcomings, but we are also saying that there are lots of complements, of complementary tools, of alternative modeling tools and classes and schemes currently developed by a lot of researchers, either in universities, in laboratories, or also in public institutions like the AFD, the French Development Agency, l'Agence Française de Développement, with people like Antoine Gaudin that you may know, etc. So to show that, in fact, we are not only criticizing, we are not only talking about epistemology and political economy and assumptions, etc., but we are also developing effective models that can be used by institutions right now for public policy making and design. Is there an issue? Yeah, en fait, tu dois juste. Et là, tu arrives bien. So it's a work written with Pierre Jacques and myself, but with several contributors, because the point was to, in fact, there were two goals. First goal, to make a kind of systemic and systematic review of the current modeling tools, and more specifically, macro modeling tools of the European Commission used in the ecological topics, issues, and public policy making. And to see what kind of criticisms we could make, and also to try to avoid the usual straw man sophism to say that, in fact, in mainstream economics or neoclassical research programs, there haven't been any progress since the 90s. It's wrong. There have been progresses. It's important to acknowledge that. At least for one thing, in order to build communication, to build dialogue. Because if we stay in our lab, in our NGOs, etc., and if we don't build a communication with economists in big institutions, in fact, we won't be able to push our diverse and complementary and alternative paradigms. And the other goal was, you know, not only to issue critics, but also to make a systematic review of the current alternative and complementary modeling tools, mainly coming from ecological economics, with some coming from the post-Keynesian tradition, others from the agent-based modeling paradigm, etc. But at least coming from ecological economics, and also to directly contact the different authors, the different researchers, in order to build like a kind of research consortium to say to the European Commission, we are not, it's not only about we can propose you lots of models, we are already in touch with all those mind-blowing teams of researchers that are really glad to be able to talk with you, to organize joint seminars with you, to allow you to appropriate those models in order to develop better public policy makings, better scenarios and trajectories for the ecological transition, which would be efficient, socially fair, etc. And so all the contributors here are like the team leaders of the different ecological economics models that we are presenting in this paper. So a few words of introduction about our paradigm. So as you know, models play a central informational role in the development of public policy by democratic institutions and public decision makers. Okay, that's obvious. You're in last year of master. I think you're aware of that. So let's move. So we are focused on the European Commission with its various DGs. So the Directorate General, so there are DGs, the main DG is the DG ECFIN for Economic and Financial Affairs. There are the Climate DG, the Trade DG, the Energy DG, the Growth DG, the Fiscal DG, the Transport DG, the Employment DG, etc. So all the Directorate General that are helping the European Commissioners to build directives, to build plans, etc. for the European Union and maybe to be proposed as bill, as European directive for the European Parliament. And so there have been lots of, for the European institutions themselves, relatively quite strong proposals the last few years. So of course, you all know the European Green Deal, which can be inspired a bit by the New Deal under Roosevelt in the 30s in the US. The European Climate Law, proposed also by the European Commission last year, with a clear goal of reaching climate neutrality by 2050 as a legal obligation. So it's a binding law for member states. Also with an intermediary objective of reducing net carbon emissions by 55% below the 1990 levels by 2030, that's the Fit for 55 plan, and through the Health Environmental Action Programme to 2030. So it's not to say that everything is perfect, but it's to acknowledge that European institutions, whatever the causes, maybe public opinion pressure, scientific pressure, recomposition of the political struggles and party in different institutions, etc. But they are at least publicly committing for the ecological transition, even in terms of legal obligation. So we could say, okay, great deal, it's beginning, it's starting, things will get better and better, that's perfect. But those deals, those laws, those legal obligations and transitions, that's huge objectives that require a massive structural transformation of the European economy, both supply and demand side. And in the legal joint objectives, they even say that they want economic growth decoupled from resource use, and also a transition with no person and no place left behind. So they are integrating more and more, like in the social social economic pathways, the SSPs of the IPCC, more and more social justice, distributional impacts of that kind of policies, etc. But there are two issues. When we are talking about models, so let's put us in the mind of a public policymaker. Maybe with EPOG, your EPOG master, you will become a public policymaker in the European Commission. Because we need people like you, so I hope so. So, of course, public decision makers themselves, they need causal traceability or tractability in order to anticipate the impact and reception of a given public policy. So they need a bit of forecast, they need a bit of information about the mechanism that will be triggered by the public policy. In fact, you know, the big integrated assessment models, the big IAM, à la Nordos, etc., from the 19th and the beginning of the 2000s years, in fact, they were doing the opposite. They were deducing from the model a socially optimal scenario with socially optimal carbon emission, and then they were still deducing from that an optimal social cost of carbon, which should have been used to fix a carbon tax, the price of carbons to internalize the negative externalities, etc. But in fact, it's no longer convincing, both for public opinion and both for public decision makers today, because they don't want to hear, oh, okay, in fact, the optimal GHG emission will be the one which will lead to a plus 4 degrees at the end of the century. No, they want to say, in fact, that's the opposite, the reverse way. We want a specific carbon emission trajectory with a specific temperature anomaly and increase by the end of the century. And under those environmental constraints, we want to find the optimal economic and social trajectories. That's really the reverse way, the inverse way. And so models must also be not only good at you know, forecasting, interpolating the good time series in the future, etc., in short or medium or long run, but also they need to be, at least in public institutions, they need to be good communication devices for public confidence and policymakers. And they need to come together with a need for transparency in the choice of assumptions. They need to be transparent. A policymaker needs to know, okay, if I use this model, what are the explicit assumptions or even axioms that may be rooted in political economy and political theories and bias, like in post-Keynesian models, that's the same, but they need transparent and explicit assumptions and axioms, because those mathematical and technical assumptions, they will drastically determine the distributionary effects and all the effects of that kind of public policies. And actually, one of the main issues is that whatever the public policymaker can be neoliberal, conservative, progressive, socialist, MMTist, whatever, even if they really want to commit for the ecological transition and at least to respect those legal obligations that they have passed, the models that are currently used, sometimes they are, in fact, they cannot even lead to the trajectories that we desire, or the results that we desire, or they cannot even be used to test the public policies that are inside the legal obligations that have been voted. So a small example, which is not linked to environmental transition, but something quite consistent. So for example, in 2019, the European Commission calculated that Italy's production level was almost at its potential output level. So the output gap was estimated at minus 0.2%. Everyone is clear with the output gap? Yeah? Okay, perfect. Okay. Output gap, just basically that's the output gap. So the output gap is in fact that's the difference between the current output, like your current peanut butter GDP, you know, and the potential output, which is like the ideal output if all the production factors were used efficiently. So full capacity utilization rates, full employment, full use of productive capital, etc. Everything is used at 100%, you would have Y star. And so the output gap is the difference between the current production and the ideal production if everything was like 100% going. And so, in Italy, the European Commission calculated that it was almost the same. But in Italy, in the same time, Italy had zero inflation and a big unemployment rate, I mean 10%, which is totally inconsistent with that. Because if we were almost at the potential output, there would be like price pressures, and there would be almost full employment. You know, the basic Phillips curve stuff with a rise in wages, then rise in prices, etc. That was not the case. So we have a model that says, oh, we say that there is a descriptive positivist fact on your economy, and we deduce that you should do such public policies. And the reality is like literally the opposite. So that's, the Vienna Circle. How did we call that? Like the logical empiricism, you know, like a kind of, we should have like concepts which would be the same, which would be used to talk about reality. Yes?
So to understand, is it that the model was then internally inconsistent? That, or I didn't get whether you're saying that it's inconsistent with reality? Because
exactly.
You assume a certain theory that output has a certain relationship and unemployment, and you don't observe that, so there we are assuming a theory.
Absolutely.
So I'm asking, is it also internally inconsistent that the model that is fed in, the theory that is fed into the model, it's giving contradicting results. So is it that, or is it inconsistent with reality?
In fact, it's a mix of both. It's inconsistent with reality because of specific assumptions that are like the consequences of a theory that has been used to build a model. Because, you know, models are like maps of the reality, and you cannot have a map with a scale equals to one, which means equal to the world. So you need, of course, to put reductionism. So you need to put causalities. You need to put functional forms. So X will trigger Y, etc. And that's assumptions. Mm-hmm. And so here we have a concrete example of assumptions used to build a model, which leads to like not like a bad forecasting of reality, but like the opposite of something which is already observable. It's not about forecasting. It's not about forecasting future. It's about a model which is not able to describe the current reality, which is observable. We have the observations. And so just a small nuance here, this work is not to highlight doctrinal oppositions. We are not talking about orthodox, heterodox, or mainstream and heterodox, or neoclassical and post-Keynesian, etc. Because lots of people are doing that. It's great. Here, we wanted to say, we are focused on pragmatism. We are modelers at the European Commission, whatever your doctrinal school, etc. You are modelers, and we all have like day-to-day, daily modeling issues, epistemological and methodological challenges, and maybe we can bring you some solutions with lots of research team. A few words on the models used in the European Commission. So usually there are two kinds of mainstream big macroeconomic models. You have either the traditional CGE, which are the computable general equilibrium models, and you have the DSGE for dynamic stochastic general equilibrium model, NK being for new Keynesian. Because DSGEs have more and more new Keynesian flavors. We will come back to this later to explain this difference. So, and I will explain what are the differences, what are the cost structure of those models. But so those models, those macroeconomic models, of course, are coupled with energy, with environment, GHG emission, energy consumption, etc. And the two main models used for that are the EQuest-3, which is an extension of the Quest-3 with energy, GHG emissions, etc. And the GEM-E3, the General Equilibrium Model for Economy, Energy, and Environment. So GEM-E3, which is a CGE. So for example, the Quest-3 have been developed by DG ECFIN, so Economic Financial Affairs. It is used by DG Employment, etc. While the CGE's models are more used by DG Climate Action and DG Energy, but not by DG ECFIN, because it's not because they are all members of continental institutions such as the European Commission that they all work together, they use the same models. That's not true. And we need to be aware that what we call sometimes by really huge simplification, the mainstream economics, that's not homogeneous. Like heterodoxy. Heterodoxy, you have post-Keynesian, you have institutionalists, you have regulationists, you have MMTs, you have Marxists, you have you even have Austrian school, because Austrians are not neoclassical, even if they are, in terms of political economy, far from the post-Keynesian, etc. But we should be aware of not always pulling everything to one block. And just to say, of course, there are a whole suite of partial general equilibrium model and specific models for the energy market, the transportation market, international trades, etc. We are not talking about those models. We are only talking about like the big macroeconomic models with the sectors, either with lots of sectors or at the really aggregate level for the whole continent. So a few words on. Have you already heard about the SGEs and CGEs model? Yeah. So someone would like to give a few words to present one of the two, because maybe you will be more efficient than me. Yeah, please.
An intertemporal optimization model, like similar to an RBC, but you have a lot of market frictions, basically, and this friction actually create that aggregate demand may have impacts in the short term, while in the long term everything is nuclear as conventional. So
yeah, exactly. So to give a few words, in fact, you know that before the 70s, 80s, what we called mainstream economics, so mainly the neo-Keynesian, neoclassical synthesis, they were using models that are quite similar to post-Keynesian models nowadays. They were using big macroeconometric models with like equation for like a list of diverse equations that you could estimate through econometric estimation one by one. You could estimate each parameter one by one by using like real-time, like empirical time series about GDP, inflation, employment, nominal wages, etc. And then you could run them to have results, and you could try public policies inside, like monetary policies, fiscal policies, in order to see what would be the result. And then in 1976, Robert Lucas, who passed away last year, wrote a really impactful paper, which is called the Lucas Critique. The Lucas Critique is the idea to say that, for example, if I... Hop. If I write, for example, like saving equations, I want to write a model and I just want to specify the behavior of the agents in the economy in terms of saving. So I will say saving is saving appears through the not consumption of part of the national income, so a part of the output is saved. Plus, an autonomous saving rate. So we say that whatever the income, people will always maybe save a bit because they are afraid of the future, etc. And Lucas, what would Lucas say? He would say that okay, those parameters, we will estimate them on past time series, the last year, the last decades, etc. And Lucas said the issue is that you cannot estimate econometrically those parameters on past data in order to see what would be the effect of a public policy on savings, because people have no reason a priori not to react to this policy. So what does it say? It says you cannot just use fixed parameters estimated on past data, because if you try a public policy on this, people will change their behavior. So none of those fixed exogenous parameters in all the post-Keynesian, Keynesian, and old neoclassical models, solo model, etc., are fixed. They have no reason to do this. Actually, in fact, usually they are fixed, of course. According to Olivier Blanchard, the former chief economist of the IMF, who last week told me again, in fact, it's really seldom when parameters change, so it's a joke. The Lucas critic is a joke. But what does it trigger? It triggers that the current mainstream models are not using that kind of modeling anymore. They are using micro-founded models. The idea is to say, oh, we cannot aggregate and estimate fixed parameters for the whole economy. We will say that the economy is represented by a representative agent that will have an optimizing behavior. So no longer fixed parameters, but more something like this. I'm the representative household, and I want to maximize the expectation of the sum of the discounting utility derived from consumption, leisure, etc. And so you will solve this maximization program, but there are no fixed parameters. They are just a kind of black box. So people will try to, maybe they will work less today because they are lazy. And maybe tomorrow they will work more because they want more money, and then they will save, which will lead to capital accumulation, etc. So it's really another paradigm. It's just to say that we cannot just have like equation model. We need optimization, micro-founded stuff, etc. And there are several consequences about this. First, in terms of public policy, the issue with optimizing behavior is that if you put a public policy like fiscal stimulus or expansionary monetary policies, etc., by the central bank, people will adapt. They will adjust to this policy. And in the vast majority of cases, mostly all cases, they will neutralize this policy. So what is the result? Either the central bank or the government cannot have any impact on the economy, at least through Keynesian public policies. That's a huge result. That's Prescott Kingland results, etc., Barrow results, Lucas results. So goodbye the state. And that is historically really intertwined with the conservative neoliberal revolution of the 70s and the 80s. It was like the academic backbones of the reduction of state interventions, of the independentization of central banks, etc. And in fact, what happened after the big financial crisis of 2008, people were like, come on, in fact, your models, everything is at the equilibrium level. There is market clearing everywhere. Public policies cannot have any impact in terms of expenditures, etc. But we have a huge financial crisis. Your models, because they are equilibrium models without financial market, without, without public debt, etc., they were unable to forecast any strong deviation from the equilibrium, which means any financial crisis, any economic recessions, at least asymptotically, because it always comes back to the equilibrium. And so mainstream economics were a bit forced to give like more rigidities, more defaults into those models in order to, you know, to stick, to fit a bit better with the empirical data, with mass unemployment, etc. So they just here. They developed lots of that's what's called the new Keynesian flavors. A new Keynesian flavor is to put, in fact, frictions, rigidities, stickiness in terms of price, heterogeneity among agents, maybe less rational agents, like bounded rationality agents, in order, in fact, to still keep like the really core equilibrium, equilibrium core of the model, but in order to fit a bit more with empirical data. So it's like un pansement en anglais. Un pansement when you have a, sorry? Yeah, exactly. A bandage, yeah, thank you very much. They have been last year adding more and more bandages, etc. And in fact, it's really important because when you talk to mainstream economists nowadays, and you try to issue some, you know, limitations about assumptions and models, they will say, oh, come on, guy, we are not in the 90s, we are not before the financial crisis. No, we have nominal rigidities. No, we have bounded rational workers. It means that, for example, workers will not immediately forecast the inflation and thus the decrease in their purchasing power. So they will not immediately bargain for better wages, and so there will be the possibility to have like a short-term positive impact of inflationary expansionist public policy. But of course, in the long run, the Phillips curve is like here, so no long-term impact for expansionary public policies. So a few other criticism against. How much time do I still have, please?
Around 20 minutes.
How much?
Like
20, 25. Thank you very much. So a few other criticisms. So maybe we will be able to talk more about it, to debate about those criticisms during the question and discussion things. I want to discuss to talk about it with you. But so we have the output gap framework, which is a issue to always assume like natural rates. So there would be a natural rate of production due to like the structuration of the economy linked to a structural rate of employment and thus of unemployment. And you shouldn't try to decrease the rate of unemployment below the rate of natural unemployment, because otherwise you would have inflationary pressures, etc. So, and this leads to the equilibrium framework and the sales laws, which is to suppose that markets always clear. It means that usually in traditional RBC's models and mainstream models, market always clear, which means demand and supply are always equal. Same in labor market, same in financial market, when there are financial markets, which is not always the case. And so the issue with equilibrium framework is that it's really difficult to have like strong and persistent deviations, like disequilibrium, like massive unemployment during years and years. That's a strong issue if you want to at least try to, not even to forecast, but to explain the current time series with massive unemployment following the 2008 crisis. And just to give you the technique, because usually those guys will say, oh, okay, the assumptions might be crazy, maybe they are too strong, etc. But whatever the causal mechanisms, and we've seen that for a public policymaker, it's important to not only to have results, but also to understand the mechanisms, the economic mechanism behind, which is not possible if you have, like Friedman, only an instrumentalist view of modeling and not a realistic view of modeling. In fact, they still succeed nowadays to have like really good fit with empirical data. How can we have like really crazy assumptions, really strong assumptions, and still have good fit with past empirical data? That's in fact that's connected with the issue of, how can I say, the standard process. Imagine the time series of GDP. So GDP. You have time, is doing something like this. Okay. And imagine your representative agent with perfect foresight, microfunding, etc., optimization behavior, give a trajectory maybe more like this. Or maybe let's say consumption would be better. And imagine that's the real data. Here, the cycles, we have the real data, and here we have the model the model proposal. How can they make the two fit? It's through the concept of shocks, exogenous shocks. That's a really, really powerful thing that's been brought by Kidland and Prescott in 1982, time to build and aggregate fluctuations. What's the idea? He say, oh, okay, we have this trajectory, but in fact, if we observe another trajectory, it's because there have been lots of exogenous shocks on the economy, on consumption, on employment, which made the optimizing behavior of agents more doing like that. the same for companies, the same for firms. But in fact, they do not say that, oh, in fact, there have been, here this shock, maybe a war in Ukraine or a global pandemic with COVID-19, etc. They just say by backward induction, oh, if we observe these fluctuations, it must have been shocks. We don't know which ones. We don't know what they are in real economy, or they call it, for example, productivity shocks. So no one has ever been able to explain me concretely what is a negative productivity shock in a model. Usually, suddenly, all the workers become totally fucked up, like stupid, and they are not able to produce correctly in the factories, and the GDP collapse, etc. But, like, I mean, come on. I just want to... too fast. Yeah, here. Here, I don't quote the paper in order not to have personal problems. But for example, a DSGE had to assume 46 hypothetical shocks in their model of Germany from 1995 to 2013 in order to still be able to explain like the real empirical fluctuations of Germany's economy. But like, as it appears, that's the quote, as it appears that many shocks are needed to capture the key dynamics property of macroeconomic and financial data. But, okay, where are the shocks? Like war in Ukraine, like a global pandemic, okay, but what are the shocks? Public policy shocks, productivity shocks, oil price or food price shocks, etc. But they don't say that. They just say, my model cannot explain the empirical time series, so whatever I say, there have been lots of numerous of exogenous shocks that people, rational optimizing representative agent will adjust to. And so it will indeed give that kind of stuff. Quickly, about the CGEs. The CGEs are older and older than the SGEs. They are more like you can think about, like usually they are really multi-sectoral and disaggregated. So you have, for example, in GEM-E3, you have like more than 50 sectors, like transport sector, energy sector, agricultural sectors, etc., which is really interesting in order to see the interdependency between production. So big Y, big K maybe doesn't make a lot of sense, especially in terms of ecological transition with diverse energy intensity, diverse carbon intensity, diverse labor market tension. So we need to disaggregate a bit. But you can think of CGEs like traditional I/O tables, so the input output. So what is used to produce such thing? On this, you add national accounts, so how it is distributed between consumption, savings, investments, etc. And you add a general equilibrium framework in order to have price adjustments and utility and profit optimization behaviors and elasticities to represent all the interactions between sectors, international trades, etc. So just to a few words. So for example, that's the ecosystem of the GEM-E3. So you have the computable general equilibrium model here, which is then connected to energy models, so either general equilibrium or partial equilibrium models, for example, a partial equilibrium model on a European transport system, a European energy model, a global, like world energy balance model, also with connections with like more environmental models about, for example, European forestry or agriculture, and of course with climatic, emission, carbon emission models. Yes, please?
Like you had exogeneity of money, but that's actually not a thing with New Keynesian DSGE models. They don't have an LM curve, they have the Taylor rule.
Absolutely.
And maybe the critique would be better to focus on the natural rate of interest.
Absolutely. So everyone is okay, I mean, a really good point. Everyone is okay with the Taylor's rule? Yeah? No, okay. So the Taylor's rule is a kind of a New Keynesian formula in order to fix in order to allow the central bank to say what nominal interest rate I want to put in the economy in order to achieve my goals. And so the good nominal interest rate should be equal to the real equilibrium interest rate, which is R star, plus current inflation, plus two things, which are the deviation between the inflation that I want for my country and the current inflation, and the difference between the current output and the potential output. And the two parameters, theta 1 and theta 2, are like the weights that I put on those goals. Do I prefer to limit inflation to preserve purchasing power of households, etc.? Or do I prefer to increase output in order to increase national income, etc., but maybe at the prejudice of more inflation? That second part, maybe we criticize the Taylor rule indeed, but a first issue is that we cannot observe R star, the real equilibrium interest rate. That's the equilibrium interest rate that exists on the loanable fund market, which basically doesn't exist. There are no capital markets, there are only financial markets. So we don't know that, we cannot observe that. It's why there is a joke among central bankers, they say it's hard to follow the stars. Because, you know, what the fuck is this stuff? No one has a clue. But in fact, about the issue about money, so real economy model, neutrality and exogeny of money, it's true that in new Keynesian models, thanks to lots also of viscosities, of stickiness of price, of adjustment times, etc., for example, expansionary monetary policies can have an impact in the short run on the economy. But at the end of the day, it cannot have a long-term impact because people will see the inflation which is triggered by this public policy, even if there is no logical, it's not because you do an expansionary monetary policy that you will logically necessarily have inflation. So, in fact, all the new Keynesian models are Friedmanian models. They are more Friedmanian models than the former RBCs because they allow for short-term impact on the economy, but not in long run. So on the short run, the Phillips curve is still like a Phillips curve. On the long run, it's like something like this, so no impact. The other thing is that it's not because you put an interest rate that you put money. In lots of models with monetary nominal frictions, etc., new Keynesian frictions like a la Gertler and Galli, Jordi Galli, or Ricardo Reis, or Kiyotaki, Woodford, etc., there are no money, there are interest rates. And when there is money, it's an exogenous money. It means that money in those models is not created by banks. They are like small seeds that are already existing and that are being shared on the capital market, on the money market. And it leads to really different impacts of having an endogenous money. Having money is a good thing, but having the good theory, which has been demonstrated empirically, that the credit that makes the deposit and not the deposit that makes the credit by Werner 2015, if you want to see that empirically by co-integration, it leads to really different results. Moreover, usually there are no private debt, or when there are private debt, it's integrated in such a way that it cannot trigger financial instability, such as a Minskian moment, and so it cannot lead to real financial crisis. Representative agent and rational expectations also. So you have all the emergent theorem about can you just represent the economy by a representative agent in terms of emergence? It's not possible. So that's all the Kiermans work following the Sonnenschein, Montel's, Debreu theorems, etc. And also, it's linked to the critique 7, you need heterogeneity at least to have distributionary effects on inequalities, because if you want a socially fair ecological transition, you need heterogeneity. Maybe not in terms of behaviors, but at least in terms of social and economic status and structurations. And as behaviors in a materialistic world are also determined by the social economic status, of course, you may want to have diverse behaviors. And about rational expectations, a few words. It's really my take, but for me, it's not really a problem. I'm totally okay with model with perfect foresight. I mean, maybe actually, household can perfectly, in average, forecast future inflation, except for inflationary surprises like Ukraine war, etc. But in fact, there is a huge confusion in those models. Is that there is a confusion between the epistemic question of forecasting, of expectations, and the real power of agents to act after the forecast. What does it mean? It means that in such models, imagine you take a RBC model, where did I put the stuff? Thank you. Imagine, so you perfectly anticipate, forecast the future inflation. There is no exogenous shocks, there is no Ukrainian war, oil price shock, etc. So the Phillips curves will be like this in the RBC. Because if there is, for example, an expansionary public policy, everyone will anticipate the inflation and every worker will expect the decrease in their purchasing power, and thus they will immediately bargain for better wages. But that's not the fact that it's like this, at least in the long run, even for new Keynesian models, it's not linked to a perfect forecast. Because it's not because a worker in a factory perfectly forecasts the decrease in his or her purchasing power that he or her will be able to bargain for a better wage. So in fact, the implicit assumption of perfect foresight is not only perfect foresight on the epistemic dimension. It's also to say people not only forecast the values of the future, they have like an infinite like union worker power in order to perfectly obtain the wage that they want to compensate. That's not the same thing. And in terms of empirical and estimation of the Phillips curve is more like that. Like totally flattened the last years. You can see the Bank for International Settlement BIS papers on that. So maybe we will talk about the other constraints during the question. Just a small one on energy. In fact, all those models, even the one who have like which have like great advances in terms of more realistic assumptions, etc., they are overly, and the authors acknowledge it, they are overly dependent and sensitive to elasticity of substitution. Because in those production functions, you have, of course, capital and labor, but you have also energy. You can even add raw materials, etc., rare earths, etc. But in fact, if you change the parameter, for example, if you allow more than one elasticity of substitution between capital and energy, you can actually decrease your energy consumption while maintaining your output, your production, just by increasing capital. That's the concept of strong substitutability. That's the concept of Cobb-Douglas production function, which is the opposite of Leontief, where you cannot produce things without labor, or without capital, or without energy, or without natural resources, etc. Of course, it depends on the sector. Maybe in a plain building, there will be more complementary than in health services. But it's important to be aware of that. So, just a funny thing. The DSGEs of the Troika, you know, during the public debt crisis of Greece in 2011, etc. Here you have time. Here you have the growth rate of GDP. And here you have the real evolution of the growth rate, the empirical evolution. And here you have each year forecast for the GDP growth for Greece by the Troika's DSGEs. So each year, the DSGs were saying, no worries, Greece, things will go better, it will tend toward equilibrium, like potential output, zero natural rate of unemployment, etc. And each year, deflation, austerity, etc., until like 25% of unemployment and 50% among young people. So like, it's a graph made by Zero Edge, but it's coming from the leader of the research team where I work, which is Professor Gaël Giraud, the former chief economist of the AFD that you might know. So, and last word, just to say that in fact, lots of really prominent, like really well-known mainstream economists like Solow, David Romer, Paul Romer, former chief economist of the World Bank, Olivier Blanchard, former chief economist of the IMF, Kosher Lakota, which is the chair of the Minneapolis Federal Reserve, which is the most like conservative federal reserve of the US, in fact, are publishing papers saying that while we are not talking about orthodoxy, heterodoxy, but even just in terms of public policy making, those models are useless. Whatever the political doctrine or epistemology we are part of, Kosher Lakota says that, in fact, as a chair of a central bank, I think that all the macroeconometric models with econometric estimation using a time series are far more better in my day-to-day job than the big DSGs that we have in top American reviews and journals, etc. Sorry? Kosher Lakota is the chair of the Minneapolis Federal Reserve, which is it's acknowledged as the most conservative neoliberal state federal reserve of the Federal Reserve Network in the US. I will send you for if you want the slides with all the references if you want to but the references are in the paper, whatever. So we've made the work of listing all the like really concrete, systematic ecological economics model tools that exist nowadays in the literature to contact all the researchers in order to, and those contacts are in the working paper, in order to say, okay, in fact, there are complementary tools that can be used by institutions like you in order to improve your forecast, to improve your scenarios, your test of public policies, etc. And those people are aware of this, and they are totally okay to contribute in an interdisciplinary and institutional scientific dialogue and cooperation. So you have a table. We won't talk about each satisfactory, each answer to the criticism. But in fact, we have models that imperfectly answer to some of the criticisms for all the critics, which is something quite interesting. So from the issue in international trade, from that to damage functions, to inequalities, to private debt and financial stability, to the energy and physical resources constraints, etc. Yeah, please.
How do you define the robustness to the rational expectation in the column 5?
Oh, okay, yeah. There can be different ones. The first one is to make a clear distinction between the epistemic capability to forecast. So, for example, with survey samples of households about next year inflation, etc., that exists in the US, in Europe, and the wage bargaining power of workers. So to make a clear distinction between the forecasting possibility and the real current negotiation powers on imperfect markets. The other possibility is to use really bounded rationality models with adaptative expectations, with consistent expectation to have a more empirical consistency, but formalized with mathematical tools. Like for example, people, maybe they don't have stochastic rational expectation, but maybe we can represent their bounded rationality by a VAR, a vector autoregressive panel that can show that we made mistake, but at the end of the day, when we need to pay 30% higher in the supermarket or food, we understand that something is going on, for example. And the another possibility is also the agent-based approach in order to have like a heuristic and learning processes between the interactions of lots of decentralized agents with information or shocks that are sent into this. For example, in a ARIN model, it's an agent-based model with lots of evolutionary learning processes.
So it has the score, like the check mark, if it has at least some modeling of expectations and agents.
Absolutely.
Does it need to have this kind of like expectations model to well, that's later then, I guess.
Okay, but just I mean, we are here to talk about absolutely the stuff, so with pleasure just after. So, how much time do I?
5 minutes.
Okay, 5 minutes. So, just a brief description, because in fact, Pierre Jacques is the one who worked a lot on those models. As I work a lot on DSGEs, RBCs, I'm more about the criticism, but we'll just use the paper. So, for example, some of these models share a common thing, which is stock flow consistency. So when we talk about SFC models, just beware that SFC models are not a class of models. SFC is an accounting framework. SFC, a stock flow consistent model does not mean that you have specific behavioral equations with such causality, etc. SFC says that you have a rigorous accounting framework, including financial assets with assets and liabilities. You can then add money, you can then add lots of things, but at least you have the stocks, you have the flows that change the stock in each period, you can add money, etc. And it allows to integrate endogenous money, private debt, so you have far more time dependency, historical time, in order to model distributional effect and financial crisis. So, for example, it's not in the same order than in the paper, but let's do in the other order. So, really, to be quick, ARIN is an agent-based model. So, ARIN is used. So, you have lots of decentralized agents that are interacting in order to evaluate two things. First, inequalities, because there are lots of diverse population, like in Eurogreen. Eurogreen is a model that have been developed just after the yellow vest, the gilet jaune crisis in France, in order to like have tens of social economical status in order to see the redistributive impact on agents. The advantage of ARIN is that as an agent-based model, you can really model the change in expectations, for example, of climate risk or climate damages for each sector or each companies, in order to really have like a fine-tuned approach of this. About that's not in the same order. So James, for example, James, which is the model developed by the AFD, the really interesting point of James, among all its properties, is it's not an equilibrium model, which is quite seldom, even in the post-Keynesian framework. Post-Keynesian model usually is an equilibrium model, with lots of deviation and disequilibrium and rather edge balance growth, etc. But they are equilibrium model. The GEMS is a non-linear endogenous model based on the Goodwin-Kin model. What does it say? It says that it does not need to have exogenous shocks like a war in Ukraine or a global pandemic in order to have cycles, to have instability, to have deviation. And so, that's really my personal opinion, but a good model should have at least the possibility to have endogenous fluctuations and not only like a fixed point thing with exogenous shock in order to go out of the equilibrium. Yeah, ARIN, it's done. Define. Yeah, Define is a model developed by Daffermos et al. And Define is really interesting because it models lots of diverse sectors with not only energy, but all the kind of physical resources and rare earths that is used in the productive process and which is needed in the ecological transition. Because usually, in fact, environment energy models, the economic models, they use almost only energy, or they use nested production function in order to have like capital energy bundles. But we also need physical resources for the ecological transition, for the like nuclear power plants, for the renewable energy, for solar plants, etc. Power plants. So you need to have also the physical resources. DSK. So it's a really funny one. It's a dystopian Schumpeter meeting Keynes. It's a really interesting one because it mixed agent-based modeling with a stock flow consistency. So we have lots of complex interactions inside the economy, while still having the rigorous accounting framework in order to have accumulation of private debt, to have maybe financial crisis, to see the distributional effect of ecological policies. So it's a really interesting model in order especially to model tipping point trajectories where things, there is a big regime change and things things like kind of collapse or change. And finally, we have the Medeas and William project. Medeas and William project come from the same project which have been funded by the European Commission. And they are like the most disaggregated models that I know. They have like 62 industries. So it's really useful to evaluate the impact on the productive sectors of, for example, a carbon tax, or green subsidies, or green money creation to fund these public services on all the other sectors in terms of employment, physical interdependency, etc. IFREMI is the last one. IFREMI made by Cambridge Econometrics and used by DG Climate in some cases, but not by other DGs that usually do not really want to work with them. It's a really interesting model because it's a macro model, but with micro foundations of technological innovation. Because in lots of models, ecological models, you say that you have like an exogenous innovation process which will allow us in lots of years to have like really green technology, etc. But like it's a bet on the future of humanity. For example, in Nordos, the more warmer the climate will be, the more we will have technological progress in the DICE model. It's the idea that humankind will always find solution if the world is collapsing, etc. But IFREMI is micro-funding technological innovation by the behaviors of firms in terms of research and development, in terms of spillovers, and then by a bottom-up process reconstructing the technological evolution at the macro level. And in fact, those models are like really developed, they are really estimating and calibrated. Some of them are already used by public institutions, so the IFD, etc. And even like which one? EIRIN of Monasterolo et al. EIRIN have been used a lot by the European Central Bank in order to measure the climate risk, the financial climate risk of environmental damages. Because you know the first financial sector that got into green finance in the 2010s, before Carnet speech, etc., was the insurance world.
Reinsurance, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And for lots of reasons, then it spread to insurance, etc., because as the former CEO of the biggest insurance firm said, Henri de Castro, a +5 degree world is not insurable, because everything burns. You cannot insure like a world which is burning. So it's interesting also to see in terms of trending, etc. Yes, and those models have something really interesting also, and I will stop with this, is that some of them are able to study economic trending, which is the fact that the ecological transition will develop new sectors with new jobs, but they will also destroy some sectors and some jobs, especially in fossil fuels or interconnected, which can lead to unemployment. And if we want a macroeconomic stable and socially fair ecological transition, we need also to model the real capital and employment trending for sunset industries, but also the impact on the financial balance sheet and banks balance sheets of all the investment, financial investment in energy fuels industry, which would lead to like huge holes in the sheets if those assets become stranded. And to conclude, so we need different kind of models. In some cases, we need big aggregate models in order to see the macroeconomic stability or impact of such models. On other cases, you need disaggregate multi-sectoral models if you want to make a public policy on transportation to see what would be the impact on, for example, energy on agriculture. You need models in order to have a distributionary impact of taxes, for example, on poorest households. That's what happened for the yellow vest. And you need, last thing, which is a collaborative culture between institution economists, between universities, between people coming from different political economy, different paradigms, different epistemologies, in order to develop good and efficient public policies that will foster a socially fair and macroeconomic stable ecological transition. Thank you.